Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to discuss the input-output devices of a computer. Now, in the previous video, we did discuss computer hardware in general. Now, what we said was that computer hardware refers to the physical parts of a computer system. The parts that we are able to see and touch make up computer hardware. We did give examples of common hardware, including the keyboard, the mouse, the display unit, the cables and all. So all those physical cables that we are able to see and touch, they make up computer hardware. Now, the main hardware components that we have are categorized or are grouped according to the function that they perform. There are hardware components that are used for data storage, and all those hardware, such hardware components will be put into one unit that is called the memory unit. So when we talk about the memory unit, we are talking about the unit that contains or the classification of all the hardware components which are used for data storage. Devices that are used for processing, the hardware components that are used in processing are in the processing unit. And we have the central processing unit, which is made up of the arithmetic logic unit, the control unit, and the registers. So those are part of the processing unit. The third unit that we talked about was the input-output unit. The input-output unit, all the devices that are used for inputting data as well as outputting information, those are in this category. So the concept of the units, we're just trying to group, or we're identifying the groups into which the different hardware components fell. So in this video, we'll look at the input-output unit, and we'll look at the input and output devices in a bit more detail. So like I've already said, when we talk about the input-output unit, this is the unit that contains all the input and output devices of the computer. When you talk about output devices of a computer, you're talking about things like the display unit, things like the speakers, things like the printers. So all those devices that are used for giving out output will be part of this unit. Devices such as the keyboard, the touch screen, the digitizing tablet, the scanners, those which are used for capturing input, those are in the input, are also part of the input-output unit. So that's what we want to look at today. So we'll discuss the input-output devices. So let's start with, the main reason why we need these devices, the input-output devices, a computer will interact with its environment, the external environment, via the input-output devices attached to them. So you and I, in order for us to use a computer system, the computer system will need, it should be fitted with input devices and output devices. For the input devices, they will be used to provide data and instruction to the computer. Remember, in the last video, we had mentioned to say the computer cannot function. The computer cannot function without data. It cannot function without instructions being given to it. So the input devices are used to provide data and instructions to the computer. For example, when you guys are interacting, when you guys are interacting on when you're interacting maybe via social media, for example, using your mobile phone, to specify the message which you want to send to a friend. Maybe on WhatsApp, you want to send a voice note. What you do is you use a microphone on your phone to record the message. So what you're using is an input device to provide information, to provide data, sorry, to for the computer to use. In addition, you also have to give instruction. This data that I've given the computer, what do I want it to do with it? So if it is a message which you want to send to a friend, you record that message and then you press, for example, the send button. Okay. Now, pressing the send button, you are issuing the instruction. So that's what this point is trying to say. The input devices are used to provide information to the computer system. Secondly, to also provide instructions for the computer, what should it do with the data. So that is the use of input devices. Now, after the data has been processed, the computer needs to give feedback to the user. For example, when you are sending a message via WhatsApp, you've typed your message. So as you are typing using your keypad, you're using an input device to enter data. After entering the data, the next part, you now press the send button. You press send. You've given the instruction on what the computer should do with the data. After the processing has been done, maybe the message has been sent, you do get feedback via an output device. So for example, if it is WhatsApp, you maybe see those two ticks to show that the message has been delivered. Okay, so input devices used to provide data and instructions to the computer. Output devices used to provide feedback to the users. So these are the two devices that that we have. So the input-output unit, we've said, comprises of two parts. We have the input unit. Now, the input unit is responsible for providing input to the computer. Without the input unit on your machine, you will not be able to provide any input for your computer to use. The output unit is used for receiving output from the computer. So the input devices, we've already mentioned to say the input devices comprises of all the input, the input unit comprises of all the input devices on a computer. When we talk about input devices, examples of input devices, common ones, we include things like the mouse, the keyboard, the trackball, joystick, etc. Then we also have input devices such as those which we use for recording voice, videos, scanning images, etc. Now, irrespective of the input that you are providing, the input device is responsible for translating the data that you've provided into a form that will be understood by the computer. In the first lecture, the one we had in class, you will recall we had, in that class, you will recall we had mentioned to say the most common type of computers that we have today is the digital computers. Now, with digital computers, the data that is represented, the way of representing data inside the computer is using discrete numbers, digits, zero and ones. So whatever message that you are providing, when presented internally in the computer, it will be presented as a series of ones and zeros. Okay, so the input device, input devices are responsible for getting the data that you've entered and presenting it in a form that the computer will understand. That is the binary form, the zeros and ones. So you've taken a photo, but when it is presented inside the computer, it has to be converted into those digits. So it is the input device that is responsible for doing that. The input devices that we have mentioned, okay? Remember, we are just from giving examples such as the keyboard, the mouse, the trackball, etc. How do we categorize them? The most common categorization that we have is we categorize the input devices as either human data entry devices or source data automation devices. So some devices will fall in this category, in this group, human data entry devices. The other input devices will be in this category, the source data automation. This is one way of categorizing them. The other way of categorizing them is either as direct input devices or indirect devices. We'll look at these two. So human data entry devices and source data entry devices. Let's talk about this and then also direct and indirect categorization. When we talk about direct input, we mean the data is in a form suitable for processing without the need for data conversion. What we mean here is this. When you are capturing or when you are entering data, let's say, for example, you are using your keyboard. When you're using your keyboard, you press some letters or some numbers, you type a message. For example, how are you? Let me just write it down so that we can follow. All right, so let's say using your keyboard, you type your message, how are you today? Now, this message, for it to be understood by the computer, first of all, it has to be converted into a form that will be understood by the computer system. So it has to convert this into binary, into digital form so that it can understand and process the data. So this kind of input we refer to as indirect input. Why? Because first of all, the data that has been entered has to be converted into a form that the computer will understand. Then the processing will take place. There are other input devices which will capture data in a form that is ready for processing. Okay? The data which is captured is ready for processing. So meaning this conversion where you this will be taken to digital data, then presented, that part will not be there. For example, we can have data that is already stored on some storage media. Let's say, for example, on a flash drive, on a CD, on a memory stick, on a memory card. So the data that is already there is in digital form. So when we have such data, this process of conversion is not needed. And as such, that will be referred to as direct input. I hope that makes sense. So direct input, meaning the data is already in is already presented in a form that is suitable for processing without need for data conversion first. Indirect input, we mean the data that is there first has to be converted into a form that is acceptable, into a form that the computer will understand, and then processing takes place. So I hope this makes sense. All right, so moving on. Okay, so that's about the input categories. Now, we come to the other categorization of these input devices. Remember we said we have some devices which we refer to as human data entry devices. Then we also have other devices which we refer to as source data automation. Human data entry devices. These are devices that require human effort. They require human effort. The humans will be the ones who enter the data using these devices. For example, if I want to send a message to a friend, okay, I'm going to type the message using the keyboard. The message that will be presented, I'm the one who is going to type it manually. So if I want the letter U, I press on U. If I want the letter T, I press on T. If I want the letter P, I press on P. If I want the letter I press the letter I. So such devices allows the users to enter the data. Devices such as a mouse. Okay, on a mouse, you have two buttons. There's the left button and the right button. When I'm issuing instructions, for example, I want to display something, I can press the right button, and I can also press the left button. So whatever I want entered, I'm the one who is going to do that. So this is also another example of human data entry devices. Source data automation. Source data automation, we are talking about those devices that we use to enter data, but in this case, it requires minimal human intervention. It requires minimal human intervention. What we are trying to say is the data entry is automated. Most of the activities is automated. The human being plays a very minimal role in capturing the data. For example, when we talk about source data entry devices, we're talking about devices such as, for example, a digital camera. For a digital camera, all that the human will do is press a button to say, I want to capture the photo. Just pointing at what they want to capture, and then press a button. And the system, the camera itself, will do the rest. It will capture the data. If the camera was a human data entry device, it's the human who will be required to specify. They will be required to draw whatever they want captured. So if it is a face of a person, they have to draw like that. But thanks to data automation, humans, we don't have to do this. All that we'll do is just issue an instruction. I want this captured. If it's a video that I'm recording, all that I'll do is just press record. And then the device itself does the rest. Audio input, things like speech recognition. The input devices that are used, for example, to capture input. Let's say, for example, even when you are communicating on your phone, so some of your advanced phones, for example, those of you who use the iPhone, you do have a speech recognition assistant, Siri. On Google phones, we do have the Google Assistant. Now, all that you do is just issue an instruction on the using a microphone. You say, for example, open WhatsApp, and then the system itself will capture that data and perform the specific instruction. Perform that specific instruction. Then we also have devices such as scanners. Devices such as scanners. Now, a scanner will capture, will be used to capture the image of whatever you have. So there are a number of scanners. I won't go into detail trying to describe these scanners. That will be your part to look at. Okay. One of the common scanners we can think of is a barcode reader. Okay. When you go into a supermarket, you'll find that most of these supermarkets have got barcode readers. For example, let's say if we went to ShopRite and you pick up a particular item, or that the person attending to you would do is just get the item and scan it and press the barcode near the reader, and the reader will pick out all the information. For example, what is the name of the product? What is the cost of that product? It will pick that information. When you go to the library, for example, even here at CBU, when you go to the library, you want to borrow a book. When you go to check out that book, there's the librarian will use the barcode reader to scan that barcode. And from the barcode, all the information will be captured automatically. It's not the librarian who will have to type in the title of the book, who is the author. All that information will be retrieved through source data entry devices. So these are the two classes of input devices we have: human data entry devices, source data entry devices. So there are a number of examples. Deliberately, I will not go in detail describing what a light pen is, the touch screen, what a keyboard is. That information is there in your handouts. Please, I will encourage you to go through. Even on source data entry devices such as the OCR readers, OMR, MICR, the details are there in your notes. So in addition to watching this video, please read about these different devices. Why is it important? It's important to know the types of devices you have and where you can use them, in what context, for what tasks. So those details I'll leave to you to look at. So that is how we classify the input devices. Quickly, before I go to output devices, the last thing I'll say on input, we also have data collection systems that are used to record and transmit data from remote locations to a central point or directly to a computer. When we are conducting, for example, research, we're trying to study maybe let's say, for example, we're trying to look at the rainfall pattern from different places. We can use things like sensors. Okay, we use different sensors situated in different locations. And what those will do is they will capture the reading and send them to a central place. Okay, and then from there, we are able to study to say the temperature is like this, etc. Okay. Another example that we can think of relating to data collection systems. We do know that scientists try to collect data, for example, to learn more about different planets, for example, on Mars, maybe even Mercury. I don't know if they've gone that far. Venus, etc. So the humans don't physically go there, but what they will send will be automated systems. And those systems will be capturing the readings, will be capturing different data, and then send them to a particular location so that they can be analyzed. So that is a data collection system. And that's a data collection system. The input unit gets the processed data from the computer and sends it to the output devices to make it available to the users. When we're using a computer system, the aim is to get processed data. You enter the data, what you want is the computer to process for you so that you get the results. Now, those results are given via the output devices. Now, these output devices, they are the ones that make up the output unit. Okay, so the output devices is provided through different output devices, such as a display unit, display screen, speakers, etc. Now, this point is very important. I'll come back to it. Now, the output devices, there are a number of examples that we can think of. Some of the common ones would be the visual display unit, which is also referred to as the monitor. We also have devices such as the printer. These are the most common devices that we have. Now, the devices that we have, they are grouped in two, or they are classified into two categories. The two categories that we have are, one, we have hard copy devices. Now, hard copy devices, these are devices that produce output that you are able to touch. Okay? Devices that will produce output which you are able to touch. For example, a printer. A printer, the content will be printed on paper. So the output, that paper which you get, which has been printed, that is a hard copy. So we have hard copy devices that are used to produce output on hard copy. We have soft copy output devices. Now, soft copy output devices, these are devices which will produce output which we are able to see, but to touch it physically, we are not able to. For example, your display screen on your mobile phone. When a message comes, maybe an SMS, you are able to read that SMS on your screen, but to touch it, to get the actual message, you get it and put it in your hands from the screen, that is not possible. Audio response, devices such as the speaker, the message will be heard, you'll be able to hear the output, but to be able to touch that output, the actual output coming from the speakers, that is not possible. So we have devices. Some of the devices will be used to produce a hard copy output. Other devices will be used to provide soft copy output. Now, on the details relating to what printers are, the types of printers, those details I'll leave to you guys to study. Even things like plotters, what is microfiche or microfilm, what video output, those details I will leave to you guys. Now, the point I wanted to talk about, we've talked about input devices, we've talked about output devices. We also have some devices which function both as the input and output devices. Some devices will function both as input devices and output devices. On your mobile phones, for example, especially smartphones, you have the touch screen, and the same touch screen, you use it for getting output, you also use it for giving input. So it functions as both. Devices such as hard drives, flash disks, memory cards, they also function as input-output devices. You can have the output which you want to send to a flash drive. So it is just worked as an output device. The same flash drive, you can retrieve data from it. It has worked as an input device. So this device is also it's also part of the input-output unit. Now, I know for these devices, most of us have concerns. Yes, they are also under the memory unit because we use them to store data as well. So that's what I wanted to talk about. So we've talked about the input devices, we've talked about the output devices. These devices, or be connected via ports. Okay, for example, you have your flash drive. To connect to your flash drive, you have to connect it via some port. In the previous video, we did talk about buses. We talked about the internal bus and the external bus. Now, on the external bus, that is where these devices will connect to. Now, they are going to connect via some ports, the input-output ports. For example, if it is your flash drive, you'll connect it via a USB port. Okay, then there are other ports such as the parallel ports, the serial ports. So again, the details as to what you can use the parallel ports for, that is up to you to look at in detail. Okay, the firewire port, okay, so this I said you'll look at. The firewire port, this is one of the ports which we use to connect audio and video devices. For example, when you want to connect your video camera, you can connect it through a firewire port. Okay, but today most of the devices you find that we connect them via USB. That is the most common port, but there are these other ports that are there. All right, so we've talked about input devices, output devices, and I'm pretty confident you guys at least know what we mean by this. The last part which I want to look at is choosing appropriate input or output devices. We have so many input devices like we have seen. Remember, we looked at the scanners, we looked at the keyboards, the tablets, digitizing tablet, the mouse. We mentioned those as examples of input devices. We also talked about the printers, the plotters, microfiche, the speakers, etc. Now, we have all these variety of input and output devices. How do we pick a particular device to use? When you are choosing which device to use, you've got to look at a number of factors. Some of these factors will include, one, the factors will relate to the human beings. Some factors will relate to tasks. Some factors will relate to the environment. Some factors will include other constraints. Now, the human. When you are choosing an input device or output device, you also look at the people who are going to use, the people or the person or persons who are going to use that device. Some devices require expert knowledge. They require some level of experience or some level of training. They should have some knowledge for them to be able to use some devices. So when you're picking, for example, let's say when you talk about the mouse, okay, the mouse is just, we just use it to click, left click, right click. But then it requires someone to know what left clicking does, and also what right clicking does, what double clicking does. So it will require some knowledge, some level of experience. So when you're choosing a device to use, think about what the people who are going to use your computer, what are their level of education, for example. Then also, you also need to think about physical disabilities. We do have people who are physically disabled. Okay, we are not all about the same. So there are some people who have some disabilities. So when you are selecting an input device to use, be mindful of the people who are going to use, if they have any disability, so that you pick the device that will be appropriate for them. Let's say, for example, if we have the visually impaired, people with visual impairment, for example, the blind. So if when I pick an input device, I pick something which will require an eye tracking device, where as the eye is moving, input is being captured, that may not be the appropriate input device. Okay, and again, using the vision impaired as an example, giving output on the screen, the conventional screen, again, that is not appropriate because they are not able to see, or they have challenges in seeing the content. So that output device may not be appropriate for them. So when we talk about the human, when you're selecting an input device, please be mindful of your users who are going to use this computer system. The task. The task that you are performing will determine the kind of input that you need. Imagine you're trying to type a message, or you're trying to type a report. If you're typing a report, the keyboard will be appropriate. It will be appropriate. Imagine if you had to use imagine if you just had to use a mouse just to type your entire report, maybe 10-page, 20-page report. That would be a very difficult task. So the point we are trying to put across is this. It's not every device that is appropriate for every task. Some tasks will need a specific device. Okay. For example, imagine, let's say I'm trying to capture a picture. Okay, I want to show how someone looks. A camera would be appropriate for that task. But imagine if I decided to use a mouse to say, okay, I'll capture all the parts, or the keyboard to say, I'll use the keyboard to draw out this person. That is going to be a lot of work, and the output will not be so good. So the task that you're performing will also determine the kind of input device that you'll need. All right. So that's about the task. The other part is the environment. The environment, the place where the system will be used, also plays an important role. Things like, for example, the size of the environment, the space available will specify what kind of input device that you will need. For example, on most ATM machines, or I think all the ATM machines that I've seen, at least here in Zambia, you don't find a mouse connected to that device. You don't find a mouse connected to that device. Why? First of all, the size is limited. Okay, the size is limited. The physical space is limited. Then secondly, those systems are in an open place where there is dust, and as such, the mouse may not function. In addition, such places, because they are open to the public, that mouse, if we decided to be using mice for in such environments, they will not last. Okay, another example. Imagine you are trying to use voice recognition in a noisy place. Let's say you're chatting with your friend on WhatsApp, and maybe you're in a noisy place such as a market, and then you want to use voice recognition to send your message. The message will just end up being distorted. Why? The environment is not appropriate. So when you're trying to pick the input device to use, think about environmental factors. Think about the task. Think about the users. Okay. And of course, there could be other considerations such which you need to take into consideration. For example, things like the cost of the input device or output device that you need. Those are some of the factors you may consider. So as we come to the end of this video, we have looked at the input-output unit, examples of input devices, examples of output devices, what factors do you need to look at when you are selecting an input device to use. So this should give you a head start. So even as you go through the lecture notes on input-output devices, I don't expect you to have any challenges. So I wish you all the best as you continue studying. I'll see you in the next video where we'll look at the memory unit. So thank you very much for watching.